Welcome to chapel this Wednesday. That is the last chapel of the fall semester. Thank you so much for that beautiful prelude. What a way to have our hearts touched and stirred as we think about the coming of Jesus Christ into the world. And I do want to thank Trudy Poirier for her excellent leadership in music throughout the semester, and student musicians like Eddie Pune and Nate Fowler, who's been here faithfully. We really appreciate how you help support our worship. I'd ask you to turn with me in the Trinity hymnal to page 786. And for a call to worship, we'll read responsively Psalm 8. So please stand with me in reverence for the Word of God, and come in and read with me in the print that's bold. Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise.
Because of your enemies, silence the foe and the avenger.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place.
What is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him?
You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor.
You made him ruler over the works of your hands. Put everything under his feet.
All flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Let's pray together. Our Father, we give you praise as we gather this day. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who you have exalted above all things, above every name that is named. We praise you that he ever lives to intercede for us. And we pray that as we gather, we would know the comfort of the fellowship of the Holy Spirit as we gather in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. It's a delight to welcome Dr. John Currie, who will be preaching to us on this last chapel of the semester. And I'll ask you to turn in the Trinity hymnal and worship together with the singing of hymn number 195, Joy to the World.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love. Amen. Please be seated.
Our reading this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 to 7. Hear the holy word of God. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, no one rules over you. You always were and are and will be. You stand in need of nothing. You alone are true and wise and most high. You alone are good and beyond compare. Your knowledge is without beginning. You are God and Father of our begotten Son, and our God and our Savior, the creator of the whole world by him. Your providence provides for and takes care of all. Father of mercies, God of our consolation, you dwell in the highest heaven, but see us here below. Pour down your influence of your Spirit upon us. We seek your will in our lives, in our churches, and in our seminary. We pray that you will continue to be gracious to the seminary in the years to come with more students and more resources to accomplish the plan that you have had in place, and for your name to be glorified above all through the work of Westminster Theological Seminary, its president, its professors, its staff, its graduates, and students. We pray for your help in the upcoming weeks as students prepare for final exams. As a stressful time in our lives, help those of us taking the exams to do so with integrity and perseverance, and to prepare with diligence and affection for you. Grant us the understanding needed to pass the exams, but not just for the grade, but because we love you and want to know you more deeply, with our minds focused on how the education that you have blessed us with will be used in the local church to bring people before the throne of God. We pray for the church, the local congregations, and the church worldwide. There are so many local churches represented in this room this morning, and we ask that it be your will to bless them with spiritual health, with maturity and growth in their love for you, with new visitors and members coming to hear the word of God faithfully preached, and for the resources to carry out the plan you have for that church. Lord, it is you who builds your church. Help us to be faithful stewards of what you have given us. We pray for the church worldwide that you would protect her, guide her, care for her, and pour out your blessing upon her. And we look forward to that day when the entire church of Jesus Christ sits down at the marriage supper of the Lamb and enjoys the presence of her groom in all his glory. And now we pray that you would anoint Dr. Currie's lips, and that the words that he would preach to us in this moment would be your words. Pierce our hearts with the word that splits joint and marrow. Conform us more to the image of Christ through the preaching of your word. In the only name under heaven that men can be saved, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
If you're able, please stand and join us as we sing the hymn found on the handout, Who Among the Gods? Is like you, O Lord, our Lord, who among the gods is like you, O Lord, our Lord, who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders. Salvation, I will praise my Father's God, I will exalt Him. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, He has triumphed gloriously, He shatters all His enemies, a mighty warrior.
Good morning. I trust you're all holding up at this stage in the semester and perhaps just digging in for what's coming in the next few weeks. I'm glad we have some time together under the Word of God in the chapel. So would you please turn with me to the text that AJ read for us, Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6, and this morning we'll look and consider together verses 1 to 7. The text has been read for us, and so would you just bow with me for another brief word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, as we consider your word, we ask that in both our mind and our affections, that the Lord Jesus Christ would be lifted up to us both as majestic and merciful. And by your Holy Spirit, would you do what only you can do? Would you search us and test us and see if there's any wicked way in us and lead us in the way everlasting? Oh Lord, we pray for both the conviction and the comfort of the Holy Spirit as the Spirit-inspired, authoritative, sufficient Word is open to us. And so now, Lord, we pray that your Word would come not in persuasive words of human wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that our faith might not rest in any man, but in God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It was Tuesday morning. Our family was getting ready for the day. The phone rang. It was, as we say in Canada, my mum. And she said, turn on the TV. What's going on? She said, something's happening in New York. It was, of course, that dreadful event now over 20 years ago, September 11, 2001. We turned on our television and saw the horrific images of two towers burning. And as they collapsed a few minutes later, the world, as we had known it, and for many of you, the world that would shape your future, seemed to crumble with those towers. Every preacher in the country that Sunday had to decide what text are they going to turn to. I went to Isaiah chapter 6 because it gives the people of God a God-centered gospel vision in a crumbling world. It's been a long time since that catastrophe, but the world as we knew it is not the way it was. In more recent years, the crisis has been cultural. The morals of our society have begun to distort and to crumble beyond recognition. Our world has become an increasingly risky place to be the people of God, desiring to live the will of God and to do service for God. It was in just such a moment that God gave Isaiah a life-shattering, life-giving vision to equip him for life and for ministry in the world. Now, while we won't get as far as verse 8 this morning and take up the call of Isaiah, which, by the way, verse 9 and following tells him is going to be a very difficult call, while we won't get there today, by paying attention to the vision itself, we can learn this life and ministry shaping reality from the text. Here it is. When you are called to live and minister in a world that is crumbling, you need a renewed vision of God, exalted in majesty and excellent in mercy. When you're called to live and minister in a world that is crumbling, you need a renewed vision of God, exalted in majesty and excellent in mercy. Now I'm going to invite you to see three dimensions of the vision this morning. First, we're going to see God exalted in majesty. And then we need to see our own sin before the exalted God. And then we'll see God excellent in mercy. First, would you notice and see with me God exalted in majesty? It's in verses 1 to 4. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. Uzziah was the great king who had led Jerusalem and Judah for decades till pride got the better of him. 2 Chronicles 26 tells us that during the reign of King Uzziah, he went to war against the nations that threatened Judah. He was so strong that he became a regional power and extended the nation's borders. He fortified Judah's defenses, built an impressive military, and increased their natural resources. He was a king who prospered and protected the nation, and Judah had the privilege of his leadership for 52 years. But when King Uzziah became strong, he became proud, and he reached out for an office that God had not entrusted to him. God judged him, and he spent his closing years isolated as a leper, and his nation began to decline. At the same time, a new superpower was on rise in the region called Assyria. And when Assyria rolled over a nation, they did the kinds of things that CNN warns you about before they show you the footage. Think Bucha, think Mariupol in Ukraine, think the Taliban or ISIS. In the year that King Uzziah died, Assyria is on Judah's doorstep. The great, prospering, protecting king is gone. Corruption is on the rise in the nation. The culture's in decline. And there's a terrifying threat to national security on the doorstep. Those are the headlines in the year that King Uzziah died. And so God provides his prophet with a vision of who is really on the throne. The vision is designed to remind Isaiah who really reigns, who really is king. It begins, "I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne." And then down in verse 5, Isaiah interprets what he sees. "My eyes have seen the king." When God's people were living in the midst of headlines like those, God gave them a vision of himself. Excellent in majesty. Now, if you go to the Philadelphia Museum of Art and you see a great portrait, you stop and you notice the details, you try to enjoy it for all it's worth. After all, you're on a student's budget, you paid to get in. And perhaps you notice the brushstrokes, you'll maybe notice the shading, how the artist brought his vision to life. Well, if we want to be equipped for life and mission in our world, it will do us good to linger and to notice the details of this glorious vision. Isaiah records, "I saw the Lord, Adonai." That title means master, owner. The one with absolute right and absolute power to do as he absolutely pleases. The throne was high and lifted up. In other words, it was higher than any other throne. The train of the robe of the one who sat on the throne filled the temple. The grandeur of a royal robe is a cue to everyone who looks at it of the dignity, of the splendor of the person who wears it. So in just a few months, we're going to get to witness the coronation of King Charles III of Great Britain. And he will process through Westminster Abbey in a great royal robe. I don't know what his dimensions will be, but the one that his mother wore in 1953 when she had her coronation was 21 feet long. That's about two-thirds of the way up this aisle. It was embroidered by the Royal School of Needlework, and it took 3,500 hours to embroider. If you watch early episodes of The Crown, they try to capture some of the splendor as Queen Elizabeth walked through that cavernous Westminster Abbey in the regal robe. 21 feet long, thousands of hours of superior craftsmanship filling an aisle at Westminster Abbey. Here, in the vision, the whole space is filled up with the symbol. The excess of the Lord's robe engulfs the inside of the temple. There's no room in here for the splendor of another. And the power of his presence is not only seen, it's felt. The foundations of the great building shook. The whole place is filled with smoke. And at the center of the vision is the absolute master of all, on a high throne, engulfing the room with his majesty, and the smoke fills the building as it's shaken to its core. And then there's the circle of the attendants who serve the king. Think of a royal court, pages and servants waiting and scurrying to do the bidding of their sovereign. This king is attended by magnificent angelic beings, seraphim. We're not told how many there are at court or around the throne, but these angelic beings are humbled in awe at the presence of the Lord. They cover their face and their feet, a sign of humility and reverence. With two wings, they still fly, a symbol of their readiness to do the bidding of their master. So exalted is this one on the throne that his servants are magnificent angelic creatures who bow in awe of him and stand ready to fly at his service. And they perpetually praise the Lord. As we listen in on their praise, it tells us about the one who so majestically sits on the throne. They praise him as almighty, they praise him as holy, and they praise him as universal. Notice the title, Lord of Hosts, Yahweh, Sabaoth. You remember Luther's hymn? Dost ask who that may be, Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. That was the title David attributed to God when he took on and took out Goliath. You come at me with sword and with spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of Hosts, the God of the armies of Israel. That title is used 62 times in Isaiah. And coming from the lips of these beings, it declares that whatever armies exist in heaven or on earth, the Lord Almighty is over them. So that means what? Great Uzziah, who you relied on for your protection and prosperity, was not the Almighty Commander. The terrifying hosts amassing at your border are not ultimately in command. And what we need to see and believe when the culture is crumbling and all the risks seem to be multiplying is God, the Lord, the Master, is almighty, is over the forces of nature, angels and spiritual beings, presidents and their policies, foreign terrors, dictators and their armies. He is almighty. But he's not just almighty, he's holy. See, the fact that the Lord is almighty would be of limited comfort if he was capable of corruption or capable of evil. He would be just like the superstitious gods of the pagan nations, unreliable, fickle, vindictive, and unjust. But the Lord on this throne is entirely separate from the corruption and contamination of evil and sin, from moral weakness or compromise. He is infinitely and impeccably complete in purity. He's holy. And that to an extreme perfection. Holy, holy, holy. The words in Lewis's little tale about Narnia come to mind as one of the children asks about the great lion Aslan and says, "Is he quite safe?" And the answer comes back, "Safe? Safe? Of course he's not safe, but he's good." The king is almighty, the king is holy, the king is omnipresent. The great angelic praise says, "The whole earth is full of his glory." I remember the first time I ever heard this passage really preached. It was J.I. Packer at a conference in the mid-1990s. Now, if you ever saw or heard Packer preach, you know there was nothing in terms of dynamic going on. He stood there like the Oxford professor with his eyes straining to see who he was preaching to, and he expounded the text, and occasionally he'd make a gesture. And when he was done expounding this text, nobody wanted to move. And when he opened up this declaration of the angels, he described it as God's ubiquity, that the Lord is present everywhere, all the time, all at once. What that means is he's not like the pagan gods. He's not limited to a territory. There's not a zone, there's not a region, there's not a crevice, there's not a crack, there's not a corner where this king does not reside and does not rule. God, in his brilliance and power and majesty, is everywhere present, even though sinful human beings suppress the fact and deny it and rebel against him. The whole earth is filled with his glory. That's the vision that God gave in the year that King Uzziah died. In the midst of that news cycle, in the midst of a crumbling culture, we need to see God exalted in majesty. And if you see the vision, there'll be a response. And believe it or not, it won't be good. God is for us and not for them. If we see him truly as we ought, our first response will be to deal seriously with our sin. So secondly, I'd like you to see in verse 5, we need to see our sin before this exalted God. Look at verse 5. "And I said, 'Woe is me, for I'm lost. For I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.'" I remember, most of you are too young to remember, but I remember the images on that dreadful day back in 2001. Stuck in my memory are the pictures of people looking up aghast, unable to believe what they were seeing. Much more in our view at present are the expressions of anguish, of terror, of horror in our news feeds as we see the people in Ukraine. This was a life-shattering vision for Isaiah. "Woe is me, for I am lost." Lost doesn't quite capture the sense of devastation. The word means utterly ruined, doomed, made to cease. Undone is the way the older translation put it. This is a cry of calamity. This is a cry of terror. It's all over for me. This is a cry of a soul that is shattered, that is scandalized by its own guilt. See, we can become good at being affronted at the sins of the people who are out there. Those people. It's easy for us to spend much of our time with a sense of our own rightness, talking about the corruption that is so obvious in so many other people. But if we are confronted with our own sin, shattered by it, if we're not confronted by that, often our pontificating and judgments of others, if we're not confronted by our own sin, may have more to do with our own sense of self-righteousness than it does sensitivity to the holiness of God. In front of this vision of God's majesty, Isaiah was shattered by his sense of his own sin. And when you hear what so scandalized him, you might be tempted to say, isn't that a bit of an overreaction? I'm a man of unclean lips. Really? Is that not really a typical headline-making sin, is it? He doesn't say, woe is me, I'm an adulterer. Woe is me, I'm a murderer. Woe is me, I'm a thief. I'm undone in the presence of this God because I'm a man of unclean lips. Does that mean Isaiah was a potty mouth? Does it mean he was a gossip? Was he a grumbler? Well, those would all mean he had unclean lips. For example, if just for a moment, would you listen to how the book of Romans, describes sins that all deserve the wrath of God. I'm going to pick up in verse 28 of Romans chapter 1. Just listen. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They're gossips. They're slanderers. They're haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but they give approval to those who practice them. And then down in chapter 2, verse 2, he's going to say the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Now, if you listen to the list, if you're still with me this morning, there's not one of us who's not indicted by the list at some point. The holy, holy, holy one who sits on the throne of the universe takes our culturally acceptable sins of our lips much more seriously than we do. But I actually think we might get a clue into what Isaiah's particular problem was when he says, and I live amongst a people of unclean lips. Here's what God says about the lips of the people of Israel in Isaiah 29:13. He says, this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips while their hearts are far from me and their fear of me is a commandment taught by men. The people were faking it with God. Flapping their lips in religious observance according to codes they'd been taught while their hearts were not in it at all. So could it be, like the rest of God's people, Isaiah was saying right things without giving God the ownership of his heart? Was it that he was a religiously external phony? Whatever his particular sin was, the disclosure of God's majesty completely dismantled it. So can I just say this to you this morning? If you're going through the motions of religion on the outside and keeping your heart from God on the inside, you're playing chicken with the Lord of hosts. And it's a game that will completely undo you one day. Phony religious lip service is unfit for the presence of God, as is any other sin. The high definition ones, or the ones that we tolerate as low grade sins. Perhaps another takeaway is that we don't take any of our sin as seriously as we ought to. We diminish it, we deflect it, we dissimulate, we defend, we deny it. Because we do not see the exalted majesty of the one whose glory fills the whole earth and the private places and secret conversations in the corners of our life. Is the holy, holy, holy Lord exposing anything unclean in you by his presence today? Well, if he is, there's really good news. Because Isaiah's vision was not only life-shattering, it was actually life-giving. Because it shows us not only his exalted majesty and shows us our sin, but we also see him as excellent in mercy. Go back to the text, verses 6 to 7, if you would. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for." When we're confronted by the scandal of our own sin, we tend to do one of two things, maybe more, but one of two. On the one hand, we'll tell ourselves that the devastation we feel is just some kind of baggage that we carry, and we need to see God as a little more therapeutic than he is majestic. A loving God understands, and he doesn't condemn anyone. I'm okay, you're okay, God is happy with us all without having to feel bad about all of our guilt. The other thing that we might do is try to deal with the scandal our sin feels by performing rituals for God. We multiply the religious rules and routines so that we can lift ourselves up enough to stand in God's presence. My mind goes back to the scene of that now classic movie, if you haven't seen it, you need to, called The Mission. And if you have seen it, you remember the scene with Robert De Niro. He climbs the waterfall with all of his armor in a bag on his back as he tries to pay for the sin of killing his own brother, trying to pay it off. And we can do that in all sorts of ways. I'm going to deal with my unclean lips by being a rigorously religious person. You notice that God takes neither of those approaches to Isaiah. He doesn't say, no, you've misunderstood me, poor chap. You're not as bad as you think you are. Nor does he say, you can avoid the sense of doom that you feel if you just come up the steps of this altar on your knees and get your way up to my throne. No. God himself remedies Isaiah's uncleanness and his undoneness. He sends one of his servants, a seraph, to the altar, and he takes away Isaiah's guilt and sin. Through his servant, the majestic king stoops from his throne and himself provides what the unclean man needs to live in the king's presence. That stone that touched his lips came from the altar that symbolized sacrifice had already been made. And so Isaiah's religious fakery or whatever other sin it was had been forgiven. His hypocrisy was erased because God Almighty, Holy, himself met the need. But there's even better news than Isaiah received, because like the rest of the Old Testament temple system and sacrifices, this was a pointer. It was preparation for the moment when God himself would come down in the person of his son to meet the need of sinfully shattered souls. E.J. Young points out that the one who Isaiah saw in the form of a vision was the one who would later come as the Christ, because John's gospel tells us it was actually a vision of the Son of God in glory that Isaiah saw in the vision. John 12 says this, "Isaiah said these things because he saw his glory and spoke of him." Commenting on John's gospel, John Calvin says this, "John tells us that it was Christ and justly, for God never revealed himself to the fathers, but in his eternal word and only begotten Son. In the gracious plan of God, in the fullness of time, it was not an angel of God who was sent from the heavenly throne, but the Son. The one who shattered Isaiah's vision with the disclosure of his majesty did not consider the display of that majesty a thing to be held onto, but humbled himself. And in the fullness of time at his incarnation, took on our nature to live and serve as Jesus, the Savior of sinners. And he provided not a stone from the altar, but his own life and his own blood on a cross. And his sacrifice was final, the finished sacrifice for all of our sins. And it's by his once shed blood that all of our hypocrisy, all of our sin is taken away forever. In God's excellent mercy, He provides cleansing by sending his son to give himself as a sacrifice for unclean lips and unclean hearts and unclean lives in his people. But there's better news, because then he raised him from the dead. And now in majesty, he sits on the throne as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And when by faith he unites us to his Son, God imputes his righteousness to us, and he sets us apart, and he sanctifies us in Christ, so that we in Christ are blessed to stand in his presence, righteous and holy. And so if you're undone by seeing God's exalted majesty, see his excellent mercy in Christ. Let him touch you. Let him cleanse you. Let him remove your guilt through faith in Christ. Trust the Son. Turn to the Son who died, who's raised, who's exalted and reigned. And if you believe in him, stop trusting the powers and the people around you and put your trust in him. And then as a living sacrifice, because of the mercy of God, present yourself to him in his service. When you're called to live and minister in a world that is crumbling, you need a renewed vision of God, exalted in majesty and excellent in mercy. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for your word that reveals your Son. We thank you that as we have sung and as we celebrate in this season, that you in your love sent your only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And so, Lord, by your Spirit working through your word, would you help us to see your glory, cling to your mercy, and in that be compelled in your service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think we are to stand and turn to hymn number 194. Hymn number 194.
To as by thy drawing nigh, disperse the gloomy cloud aright, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou key of David, come and open wide our heavenly home. Make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path to misery.
Thank you for joining us for chapel this fall. You are dismissed to your prayer groups. Go in peace.